Now, I'm getting old and forgetful, so I have to write things down. So you're going to have to bear with me there. I want to congratulate Beth, all of you folks and the teams that are here for the great years that you've had. You've just been magnificent. So you're aware that there have been a number of other Penn Staters that were Olympians besides myself. There was Kurt Stone. He was one of the fellows that really got me involved in this after World War II. I was back there looking for something to do in the track because I couldn't have my wife here. And I was out on the golf course trotting around. Now, I had a little experience in the military or money, but nothing serious. So Kurt said, hey, kid, why don't you go out to the team? You get a shower, you get a locker, you get a towel. That sounded good to me. In 1945, after the war was over, it was over for me. So that was the start. Now, Kurt was a three-time Olympian, but I didn't know that then. He's a pretty quiet guy. He doesn't tell you much. You'll find out later how good he where he was. He'd come down to our trailer and sit in there and have a book, and he'd be going through it like this, and he'd do a book report in about an hour and a half with a typewriter and that sort of thing, you know. And he was considered some real good person, and very right. He was a three-time Olympian. Now, Barney Ewell was another gold medal winner here. He was the sprinter. He was here at the same time I was here. He would spot me about 40 yards and beat me by 20. That's how fast he really was. He was a tremendous athlete. People didn't really know how good he really was. He was a boxer, he could fight. He could also was a football player in the Navy while he was in the service. So he had a lot going for him. He had other problems, but so did we all. Now, the other couple of Olympians that are not here now, my brother Bill. He got into track late, so as I did, and it turned out that he could run pretty well. And then younger brother Don, we had a three-legged group for one of the 10 relays, and another kid named Freeburn, so that made four, and we won. we had a good group back in those days. My first running here was on the half-mile track as a schoolboy. Back a half-mile, we had a, when I grew up as a kid, we had a half-mile lane, and this was the Glenn Cunningham's day. I used to trot that when I was about 10 or 8, back and forth. We really had to go out to get the school bus anyway, so out one way and back at night. But another fellow that you should think about a little bit over these years is Leo Lou Zamperini. Now maybe some of you have read that book of his. He was some 400 days on a raft. Japanese had shot him down. Lou Zamperini also was in my era. He was about 6 years ahead of me. And we both were beaten by the same man, different times. He was beaten in 36, in the 36 games by this chap. And this chap was not going to come back in 1946, and he beat me in New York. So we were both beaten by the same fellow. Here. I can't even read all my own writing, that's another. My high school athletics really were the football, baseball, basketball, and track. In fact, we won me a year. We went to school, we had about 35 people in our graduating class, so it wasn't very big. And you got to do everything if you wanted to do it. And I tried. I was second in the mile at about 4:30, and I was first in the high jump at 5'6". So you know what kind of competition we had. But we had fun. At Penn State, my first 2 years were, I was a two-year Aggie, this was 1947. 42, and I tried the intramural boxing and I had three bouts. I won the first two, that was a mistake. Then I hit a fellow that could fight. That was the end of my boxing. But it was fun. But I tried everything. And I was in the service from 42 to 45. I was a pilot. I flew fighter planes down in Georgia and Mississippi, and now in Florida. You know, when you give a 1,200 horsepower toy to a guy and let him have it, you know, I had a lot of fun. But it didn't last. The war was over in December or in August of 45, and in September, I was home. They said, we don't cannot pay any more to home. And that's the way it was in after World War II. Okay? Coming back to Penn State, they said that you'd come back anytime I wanted. Well, I said, okay, I'm going to take the first semester off. I get back here in January, and they said, we don't have room for you. Well, that created a little argument. I won that one. And I think I found a place to stay, but there was no room for my wife. Now, bear in mind, this lady is a spectacular lady, and without the cooperation of her, I would not have been anywhere near here, there, or wherever. She made it all possible. I'll guarantee you that. We had four boys. They're all fine and dandy. In Finland, she'd gone along, and we're over there, and we had two children by then. One was with each grandmother, and she said, we've got another one coming. That was the way it went back in those days. But we had a lot of fun. We had a place here in Penn State. We had a trailer down here that they put up. And these things, you carried your water in and you carried your water out. So you know, this is pretty rudimentary living for a while. Let's see here. Now, part of the physical training in the Air Force was what we call Burma Road. And this was about a 2 to 4 mile thing. I got fairly decent at it, so I had some experience here. But when Stoney got me involved with the tractor, and Chick Werner was the coach then. And by the way, at that time we had two coaches that were really coaches, Chick Werner and Norm Wood. We were both very capable and good fellows to be working with. I was old enough to travel with them as a sort of an elder coach, I guess you'd call it. When Kirk shot and introduced me to Chick Werner, he said, what do you want to run, Chick? I said, well, you have a 2 mile. He said, can you run 2 miles? I said, I can run 2 miles. You're on the team. That's the way it was in 1946. And from then on, I was pretty fortunate. I didn't have any accidents or things like that. So we had a pretty good set of times back then. I didn't know about the steeple chase until about 1949 or something like that, 1950. But in 52, payback, in 1948, I tried for the 10,000 meter run in the steeple and the National AAU Championship. Well, it was 101 degrees, and I had a bad day. I thought I could win, and I came apart with 2 laps to go. If any of you ever had a lead stroke like that, but you know what it's all about. The good thing about that was Herm Dofberg was in the race, and he finished third, got to run in the 48 games, and I stayed home and cheered for it. But that was okay, because now I know a little bit more about the running. The steeplechase turned up, which is something I learned to do, and it worked out pretty well for me. Brother Bill was also a lanky guy. He came along and he said he tried running too, and he was pretty good at it too. So the two of us finished first and second in the American steeplechase championships. He went to Finland with us, but he didn't make it through the trials. So I was the one that made it, and fortunately it worked out well for me. So. If 56 came, I got into, I made the team, but I was over the hill. People that had been there in 40 and 52 were just that much shorter. They were pretty thin than they could be. But it was a good run. I had a good time. Now, I want to just thank you all so much for allowing us to come. I hope I can be helpful. I hope you can help Beth continue what her work is here. I'm going to try to help too. And you have any questions, any serious questions that are worth giving a try? Thank you all very much for allowing me to address.
Of course.
The question was, do I have any memories of traveling to the Olympics in 1952? Yes. We went aboard a DC-7. It was a propeller plane, 11 hours to Sweden. And that's where we didn't land in Finland, but we landed in Sweden. I think that was the first stop. I think they needed gas. It was 11 hours. It was a long trip. But I've had some interesting experiences. I spent one evening with Bill Russell. Now, some of you remember who he is. This was going to Australia and from Hawaii to one of the islands out here. Bill Russell and I shared a seat. Now, he had the seat there at one. I had the floor underneath him. His legs were all the way across in the other seat, on the other row. And so nobody kicked me or anything like that. They wouldn't dare kick him. And he was an 18-year-old young man, very, very shy, and that's a very, very nice man. Right guy. But we traveled. The travel was great. I had no complaints about that. The travel was well handled. When we had good food, lots of food, more food than you could really handle. One thing about it, I had an opportunity, really what made it go for me. I had an opportunity to train twice a day, maybe even three times a day for about 3 weeks. I got down after the Olympic run in 1952. I weighed 128 pounds. My normal weight was about 145 all along. That's how I was able to keep down the weight and maintain the strength. It was a good thing to have some extra time to train. And we did it in Princeton. We had two weeks in Princeton. I was in the FBI in Newark at that time, but Mr. Hoover didn't disapprove of good reports. So apparently he let me find one of our Princeton agents needed some help, and he should be down and help him. So I helped him for 2 weeks in Princeton. That gave me a chance work out with the team in the morning and at night. So it worked out very well. So cooperation worked out for me then. Any other questions? Yes, sir. Say this again. Oh yeah, in our town, in Glen Ridge. It used to be called the Turkey Trot. And I just said, Ashenfelter, you're turkey. We're going to call it the Passion Fellow. So that's the way it is now. We've gotten now, we have a fellow named Danny Miller, Danny Murphy, who's running it really. All I do is start to run. I used to run it, and it's called the Trekking Trot. It was sort of fun. But we now have about 2,600 people running it. And we have a fun run for kids, little cares. And kids with ambulance, with a fire, and that sort of thing. It's a fun thing. Yes, sir.
Where do you keep your gold medal?
It's up there in the football thing, what are you going to do with it? I kept it in my sock drawer. I've got four boys. What are you going to do with it? That's where it belongs.